it's a little bit faded, but I'm not sure if you can tell. I can attempt to show it to you, but it kind of looks like it's all there. Yeah. So it doesn't really show it like it does in real life, but it is a little bit faded. But I'm going to start reading chapter one. It's where E.T. comes to Earth, just like we see in the movie. It's one of my favorite movies of all time, too. beside its neighbor, a little flower of antediluvian make. The extraterrestrial botanist gazed at it for a moment to see that it all was well, then turned and recrossed the greenhouse. He moved beneath Japanese cherry blossoms, hanging Amazon flowers, and some ordinary horseradish that leaned his way lovingly. He patted teachers. His only interest was a little redwood He liked humanity too, and as always. When his heart light glowed, he wanted to teach them, guide them, and give them the stored intelligence of millennia. His shadow shoved up before him in the moonlight. Head is shaped like an eggplant on a long stalk of a neck. As for his ears, they were hidden in the folds of his head, like the first shy roots of a baby lima beans. No, Earth would have too good a laugh were he to walk up its aisle of world government. Not all the stored intelligence in the universe was enough when people were laughing at your pure rich silhouette. He kept it hidden in the moonlight and with faint mist attending it, and proceeded on and down the road. Inside his head, he received the warning signal from the ship, but knew it was premature, knew it was to give the more clumsy footed of the crew time, but he swung one duck-webbed monster of a foot forward, and then the other. He was fast, by any standard of speed on Earth, of course. He was impossibly slow. An Earth child could move three times as fast. One had almost run him down with a bicycle one terrible night. Close, very close. But not tonight. Tonight, he'd be careful. He stopped, listened. The ship's warning signal came on again, thumping in his heart like the code of alarm. The instrument fluttered lightly, calling for a roundup of all crew members. Second preliminary message. But there was time enough for the swift. He waddled left, right, left, knuckles fairly swinging in the leaves as he dragged along towards the edge of the town. He was old, but he moved well, faster than most 10 million years protagonists with feet like marsh ducks. His great orbicular eyes rolled, scanning the town and the sky and the trees and the ground immediately ahead. No one was coming from any direction, only himself, coming star intelligence in seven galaxies could not help him move faster in the foreign element. He had stuck his toes. How absurdly useless they were. He felt the swiftness of human feet upon their own ground, advancing all around him, and knew what a fool he'd been to tempt them. Their quick thumping sound and cold streaks of light cut the brush over and over. Their alien tongues bellowed, and one of their number, with much jingling at his waist, was on the scent. In the flashing light, the old botanist saw the man's belt with something hanging from it like an assemblage of teeth, jack-edged trophies, possibly wrenched from the mouth of some other unfortunate space creature and placed on a ring. Time, 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 called the ship, rounding up its last stragglingmembers. He launched under the searching lights to the edge of the fire road. The vehicles were scattered, as were the drivers. He turned on his protective mist and glided across the road in the moonlight, blending with the foul exhaust from their engines, the noxious cloud momentarily adding to his camouflage. And then he was across the road and sliding down a low ravine. Just as quickly, their cold lights turned, as if sensing where he'd cross. He huddled against the sand and rock as the Earthmen leaped across the ravine. His orbiting eyes raised upward, and he saw the horrible ring of jiggling teeth, grinning hideously as its owner leapt over him. He crouched deeper into the rock, mist around him. No different from other little patches of fog one sees in ravines by night where the moisture clings. Yes, I'm just a cloud, Earthlings, one of your own, insignificant. Don't probe it with your lights, for there is a great long neck inside it, and two webbed feet with toes as long and spindly as the roots of a purplish toad shade plant. You wouldn't understand, I'm sure, that I'm on your planet to save your foliage before you've completely annihilated. The others jumped over him, dark voices excited, enjoying the hunt and well-armed. He scampered up after the last one had passed and entered the forest behind them. His only advantage was his knowledge of his beloved terrain, from which he'd been gathering. His eyes revolved quickly, locating the trail, a faint indentation in the gathering of branches that netted the darkness. A path he and his crewmates had made while bearing the seedling away. The rough, ungracious light stabled the dark, shining at different angles. sudden group decision flooded him, a feeling that swept through his very bones. The hatch closed, petals folding inward. The ship lifted off as he burst from the grass, waving his long-fingered hands. But the ship couldn't see him now. Its enormous power thrust was being impossible.